أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وزد وبارك عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين، وعلى أصحابه وأحبابه ومن استنى بسنته واقتفى أثره ودعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، الحمد لله that we are able to meet again and again and again to study our deen and to remind each other. In the beginning of my talk today, I would like to welcome Imam Abdullah Smith to Biscarraway. MashaAllah, Lakhwatir Billah. Mr. Abdullah, I met with him in an event a few days ago, right? And I welcomed him, alhamdulillah, to the community. And when I heard the announcement of his name, I was happy, mashallah. I thought the brothers got the right person to the community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and make his effort in our community successful. Allahumma ameen. And we will always remember Imam Rauf, who lived with us for a long time serving the community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept his effort, and you always remember him in your dua. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a long life and grant him every good. Allahumma ameen. Subhanallah, for the last 2 months, every time I sit behind the microphone, I feel that it is not proper for me to speak about something not related to what is going on to our Muslim brothers in Palestine. Every time I speak to my community in Jeju City or to any of our Muslim brothers in the masajid, I feel that it is very, very important for the Muslims to understand what is going on in Palestine. In the beginning, we need to remember that الصراع بين الحق والباطل existed on earth from the beginning of life. The conflict between good and bad, between good and evil, it started on earth from the beginning of life, from the time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down Adam, our father Adam, and our mother Hawa with al-shaytan on earth. So the conflict between good and bad started since then. And this conflict will remain until the day of judgment. This is something that we need to remember all the time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did create us to test us. We are a test. And part of the test is to deal with enemies. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍ عَدُوًّا. So Allah said subhanahu wa ta'ala that He made for every prophet an enemy as test. So Allah testing the prophet. Enemies from mankind and enemies from mankind. And the Muslims, when they deal with their enemies, they must be guided by the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Quran, هذا بيان للناس. هذا بيان للناس. وهدى وموعظة للمتقين. So this Quran is guidance for people. This Quran is a clear statement revealed to be guidance for people and a reminder to those who have piety, to those who have righteousness. Allah Azza wa Jal said in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah about the Quran, He said, هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So the Quran is guidance for those who have piety. In Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوى. Indeed, this Quran guides to everything good in dunya and akhira. إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوى. So the Muslims must be guided in the Quran in the time of ease, and must be guided with the Quran when they face hardship. The Muslims must be guided by the Quran in the time of peace, and must be guided by the Quran in the time of war. So everything happens, we need to refer back to the Quran and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to know what to do, how to deal with the situations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to live a day of ease, a day of hardship. And He wants us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be in the time of ease, thankful and appreciative. And He wants us in the time of hardship to be patient. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah wants us to be patient. Holding on to the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in Surah Al-Hujurat, Ya ayyuha الذina amanu, O you who have believed, لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله. إن الله خبير بما تعملون. إن الله سميع عليم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم. Oh, you have believed, do not put yourself before Allah and His Messenger. Don't put your opinion. Don't act upon what you think. Always be guided by the Quran and the Sunnah. Make your decisions based on the Quran and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's very important for the Muslims when they face anything in life to refer to the Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran and the Sunnah will guide you, will show you how to deal with situations. When the Muslims are watching the news and following what is going on in Palestine, I see messages in their eyes. People are asking why. Why the Muslims are suffering, especially in Palestine, for 75 years? Why? Why people are getting killed? Now, 19,000 people got killed until now. 19,000 people. The people who are injured badly, about 60,000 people. Why? People are asking why. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the Quran, ولا تهنوا ولا تحزنوا وأنتم الأعلون إن كنتم مؤمنين. Do not weaken and do not grieve. You will have the upper hand if you really believer. If you really believer. And we all experienced that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam suffered in the early days of Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end made him victorious. In Sahih al-Bukhari al-Muslim, narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is narrating to us, something happened in front of him to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the beginning of Islam. We all knew that Prophet Muhammad alayhi wa sallam started his da'wah individually, talking to people one on one for 3 years secretly. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to announce his prophecy. And he did, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then people started to go against him, alayhi salatu wasalam. The leaders of Quraysh, the tyrants of Mecca, they did not want to believe in Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam, out of arrogance. Because none of them wanted to lose his position as a leader. He want to follow his desire. He want to make decisions. He want to live according to his own way. He doesn't want to submit his will to Allah's will. He does not want to give this leadership to Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So I will show you how they dealt with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. In this hadith in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam one day was praying beside the Kaaba. And then Abu Jahl, Amr ibn Hisham said, من يأتينا بسلى جذور بني فلان فنضعه على رأس محمد إذا سجد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Who who can go and bring Sala al-Jazur? Sala al-Jazur is the stomach or the womb of the she camel. You know when people slaughter the camel, they clean the body and get this stomach out, this blood, the impure things. So Abu Jahl is saying, we need somebody to go to bring the stomach and the womb of the she camel of the family of so and so. They just slaughtered a camel. So we can put it on the top of the back of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the top of his head when he prostrate. Mas'ud said, فَانْبَعَثَ أَشْقَى الْقَوْمِ عُقْبَةُ بْنُ أَبِي مُعَيْدٍ. The worst of them, عُقْبَةُ بْنُ أَبِي مُعَيْدٍ, said, I will do this. So he went and brought this filthy and impure stuff. And once Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prostrated, they put it on the top of his head, alayhi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the back. Ibn Mas'ud said, لَا أُغْنِي عَنْهُ شَيْئًا. I was not able to do anything. Ibn Mas'ud was just one person, and he's not able to defend the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. If he announced that he is Muslim, he will be tortured, and he will never find somebody to try to protect him. So he was watching, very sad, but he's not able to do anything. Until the daughter of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, Fatima, came and kept making dua against him, cleaning the back and the head of her father. The Prophet ﷺ is still patient in his prostration position, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the Prophet ﷺ raised his head from the sajda, and he kept making dua against him. Allahumma alayka bi Quraysh, Allahumma alayka bi Quraysh, Allahumma alayka bi Quraysh, Allahumma alayka bi Abi Jahl, Allahumma alayka bi Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayyid. The Prophet ﷺ made dua against Quraysh. He asked Allah Azza wa Jal to punish Quraysh, and to punish Abu Jahl, to punish Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt. He kept mentioning them one by one, name by name. He counted seven people, alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibn Mas'ud himself said, after the migration of the Prophet to Medina, the mushrikeen came behind the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, to the border of Medina. They tortured the believers in Mecca and killed some of them, abused some of them, tortured some of them, and then after the migration of the Prophet to Medina, they went behind him, alayhi salatu wasalam, to fight him in Medina. They wanted to conquer the city of Medina, to kill the believers, and to end the presence of Islam. But subhanAllah, one day before this fight, the battle of Badr, the Prophet was walking with the companions in the battlefield and showing them where exactly Abu Jahl will be killed tomorrow. Abu Jahl will be killed here, he said, alayhi salatu wasalam. Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt will be killed here. Shayba ibn Rabi'a will be killed here. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam showed them the seven spots that these seven people who did this incident will be killed in the battlefield of Badr. And subhanAllah, each one of them got killed in the same place the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam pointed his finger to. So this narration tells us that once we say, I believe in Allah, you will have enemy. You need to understand that. Once you say, I believe in the Messenger of Allah, I believe in the Quran, you will have enemy. It's not up to you. And those enemies will do their best to try to drive you away and avert you from the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They may use physical abuse if they are able. They may declare war if they are able. You can see what is going on to our brothers and sisters in India. You can see videos, at least. If you are not Indian, if you've never been there, if you don't know what's going on from there, you can just see videos. What is going on? People full of hate, trying to abuse and kill the believers for no reason, except that they are believers. In Sahih Muslim, it is narrated by Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم he used to come to pray beside the Kaaba in the days of Mecca, and one of the of al-Mushrikun, Abu Jahl, said, every time Muhammad comes to put his face on the dust in front of you and you are doing anything, you are doing nothing about it. If I saw Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام putting his face in the dust in front of me by Lat and Al-Uzza, I will step on his head. So one day the Prophet was praying عليه الصلاة والسلام, and then he was with his friends, Abu Jahl with his friends beside the Kaaba. So they told him, you swore by Lat and Al-Uzza, if you saw Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام putting his face in the dust, you will step on his head. He is putting his face in the dust now. What are you going to do about it? So he said, I will do it. Then he walked toward the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, wanted to step on his head. But subhanAllah, they saw him walking backward. What is going on? Why you are stepping back? He said, between me and him, a trench full of fire. He saw angels flying with wings in front of him for the protection of the Prophet ﷺ. He saw all that and he did not believe. Imagine you are going to fight with somebody or to hurt somebody and you see a trench full of fire between you and him for his protection. You see angels flying in front of you with wings. Hadith in Sahih Muslim, authentic hadith. And subhanAllah, he did not believe, because the person who is arrogant, he is blind. The arrogant person is blind. He doesn't see right from wrong. Like the Pharaoh. You remember the Pharaoh when he was chasing Musa alayhi salam, running behind him. And he saw by his eyes what happened to the sea. The water of the sea, the sea split to two mountains of water in front of him. There is a way for Musa and the believers to survive. And this miracle is not making him to believe. Because once the arrogance established in the heart, the person is blind. He is not seeing between right and wrong. He's not able to distinguish between good and bad. So subhanAllah, he was not able to come close to the Prophet, and the Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام, if he took few steps toward me, few more steps toward me, the angels will snatch his parts, part by part. يعني, if he took more steps toward me, the angels will take the hand and the leg, they will snatch his parts from his body to protect the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. In another narration, Urwa ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said that one day he asked Amr ibn al-As about يعني, what happened to the Prophet in the days of Mecca. And he told him, one day the Prophet was praying and Abu Jahl came, or Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt came from his back, tried to shock him. Imagine the Prophet is praying and for no reason, just Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt is coming from the back of the Prophet to try to shock him. Until Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu came in rush and took Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt away from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he was saying, أَتَقْتُلُونَ رَجُلًا أَيَّقُولَ رَبِّيَ اللَّهِ. Are you killing a person just because he is saying, my Lord is Allah, my Lord is Allah? So subhanAllah, what you hear now, what happened with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions is repeated in all the time. If the enemies of Islam have a chance to abuse, they will abuse. If they have a chance to kill, they will kill. One family, like the family of Ammar ibn Yasir, you know, the mother of Ammar, Sumayya, was killed just because she became Muslim. Nothing, she didn't do anything at all. And her husband, Yasir, was killed. Her son, Abdullah, was killed. The leaders of Quraysh tortured them just to leave Islam or to curse Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even Ammar himself, they kept torturing Ammar to curse the Prophet alayhi wa sallam until he arrived to a level that he was not able to take it anymore. So he cursed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he went to report himself to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and said, O Messenger of Allah, I destroyed myself. هلكت. What happened? He said they tortured me until I did this. I said this. So the Prophet ﷺ did not tell him anything until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهُ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet ﷺ that if the person was forced to say something out, he was not saying it with free will. He was forced to say it against his will. He would not be held accountable. So the Prophet asked Ammar, أَقَلْبُكَ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ؟ يعني, are you tranquil in your, with your iman in your heart? You believe? You really believe in Allah and His Messenger? Ammar said, yes. So the Prophet said, إِنْ عَادُ فَعَدْ. If they tortured you to curse again, curse again. Because you are not doing it with free will. Right? And the Prophet tried to make it easy for him. If you are abused and tortured, Allah will not punish you for that. Because you didn't do it by free choice. So as you see, Bilal ibn Rabah, radiallahu anhu, they put Bilal ibn Rabah half naked on the desert under the heat of the sun. And they put very big rock on his chest just to curse the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he kept saying, Ahadun Ahad, Ahadun Ahad. He's seeing people around him are getting tortured and they are not able to take it. So they do what the mushrikeen want. But he said, even if he will lose his life, he will not utter a word against the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Keep saying Ahadun Ahad. So this tactic is used before and will be used until the day of judgment. We need to know that. This is the nature of our way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to understand it. If they have the chance, they will do it. And they will use other tactics. They will come to call the Muslims names. And we need to have this, to be ready for this battle of awareness and perception. The Prophet alayhi salam, the man who was the most truthful, the most trustworthy, the most wise, after he announced his prophecy, they called him the opposite. He became the liar, the magician, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he started to call him names, alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is the way of the enemies of Allah all the time. You know the story when Al-Husayn ibn Salam, Al-Husayn ibn Salam used to be one of the leaders of the Jewish community in Medina. And he came to the Prophet ﷺ and he accepted Islam and he told the Prophet ﷺ to ask the Jewish leaders about him. So he was hiding himself and the Prophet ﷺ invited the Jewish leaders and asked them about Al-Husayn ibn Salam. The Prophet changed his name from Al-Husayn to Abdullah ibn Salam. So the Prophet asked the Jewish leaders about Abdullah ibn Salam, what they say about him, what they think of him. So they said, Sayyiduna ibn Sayyidina. He is one of our leaders, the son of our leader. He's our master, one of our scholars. So the Prophet said, how if I tell you he became Muslim? They said, Nu'idhu billahi min dhalik. And you seek refuge with Allah that he becomes Muslim. They don't want to even hear it. So the Prophet said, Ukhruj alayhim. So he came out, the Prophet told them to come out, he came out. While he's saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So once they heard him saying that, they started to change what they said about him. After they said he is one of our scholars and one of our leaders, and he is our master, they started to say, Safihuna ibn Safihina wa Jahiluna ibn Jahilina. So they started to curse him and to curse his father, to say he is an ignorant and he is Safi. Safi is the one who doesn't know right from wrong. Subhanallah. Change it immediately. Same thing the Pharaoh used to say about Musa alayhi salam. The Pharaoh used to kill the children of Israel. He's killing tons of people, right? Intentionally. And when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam accidentally, when he was separating two people fighting with each other, and he pushed one of them, so this man lost his life. So the Pharaoh is telling him, وَفَعَلْتَ فَعْلَتَكَ الَّتِي فَعَلْتَ.
وكنت من الكافرين.
So he's saying the unintended mistake of Musa عليه السلام is big crime, but his killing is something normal, right? The Pharaoh was telling the people, إني أخاف أن يبدل دينكم أو أن يظهر في الأرض الفساد. So the Pharaoh is afraid that Musa عليه السلام will change the religion and he will do corruption on earth. The Pharaoh is afraid that the Musa عليه السلام will do corruption on earth. So it is like that. You will find in our era people, they kill people and they call you terrorist, right? They kill the Muslims in Bosnia and Herzeg, but you are the terrorist. They kill Muslims in Afghanistan, whether the Soviet Union or at the time of their occupation in Afghanistan, or even Americans. In Iraq, they kill Muslims. In Syria, they kill Muslims. In Palestine, they kill Muslims, but you are the terrorist. They steal your wealth, and you are the thief. And they will keep repeating this until you believe it. Right? So you need to be aware of what they are doing. And you need to trust yourself. You are a believer. You are a peaceful person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send a prophet to kill people. The Prophet alayhi wasallam was sent to guide people, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to teach them how to live according to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet lived in Mecca 13 years. He did not fight with anyone. They started him killing the Muslims, abusing the Muslims, torturing them, stealing their wealth, until they were forced to migrate to Abyssinia twice in these 13 years. And then the great migration happened. And the Prophet والسلام, and the believers of Mecca migrated from Mecca to Medina. For which reason? They did not fight anyone. They just were looking for freedom of speech, to be able to speak about Allah, to speak about His guidance, to be able to practice their deen. Nothing else. And even after the migration of the Prophet ﷺ to Yathrib, if you look to the history of the Prophet, you see the battles and the wars that happened in his time life, you will find them better. They came to the Prophet ﷺ to the border of Medina. He did not go to anyone. The second war, Uhud, the Prophet came to Mecca, or Quraysh came to the border of Medina. Quraysh came to the border of Medina. The war was beside the battle of Uhud, the mountain of Uhud. And the mountain of Uhud in Medina or in Mecca? In Medina. They came to him, alayhi salatu wasalam. He did not go to them. Even in Ahzab, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and the believers suffered 3 years living under siege in Mecca, in Sha'b Abi Talib. Allah relieved them from it. And then in Medina, also they put the Muslims under siege in the battle of Al-Ahzab, when the Prophet ﷺ needed to make a trench to protect Medina from the conspiracy of 9 tribes collected 10,000 soldiers to invade Medina and to end the presence of Islam. And they are calling the Muslims terrorists. Subhanallah, the Muslims were killed in Mecca. And after their migration, they are going behind them there, right? And then they say Muhammad was violent, alayhi salatu wasalam. Why? Because at the end of his life, he said, "Al-yawma naghzuhum wa la yaghzunana." From now on, we're not going to wait for them here to come to us year after year. We will go to them too. George Bush, the son, did that. He said he'd rather to fight his enemies in the streets of Baghdad to avoid fighting him here in Manhattan. Right? So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ became the president of the Muslim state, of the Muslim country. And any country has army. And this army for the defense of this country and the people of this country, the religion of this country, to fight for the interest of the Muslims. Why America as country has army? If you ask them why you have army, they will say what? To protect ourselves. To fight for our interest. Same thing. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ used to have army for that reason. when he became a president of a country, he needed to have army to protect the Muslims. And we, when we read the history, they kept it coming. They kept it coming to him, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he was defending. So these tactics, it will never stop. They will try to choose a different tactics. They offered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to compromise, yudhin. So they told him, how about to worship our Lord for a year, and we worship your Lord for a year. This happened in the past. And Allah answered them, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَبُدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. Allah said to them, oh, you have disbelief, oh, disbelievers, I will not worship your Lord and you do not worship my Lord. And it is happening now. They are trying to say, to compromise and to create a new religion called the Abrahamic religion. Now they are building something called the Abrahamic religion. So they want to have one house of worship for the Muslims and the Jew and the Christian to worship together in one salah. And they will make something between the Quran and the Gospel and the Torah to be guidance for people. They will select things from these books. This is exactly what they are trying to do. Don't laugh. It's reality. And it happened before. In the time of Genghis Khan, he used to have Al-Yasiq. What is Al-Yasiq? The book, which you call the Al-Yasiq. What is it? This book is something from the Quran and something from the of the Torah and something from the Gospel. Together they called the Al-Yasiq. So they're still offering these ideas to bring Christianity and Islam and Judaism in the mixer and to make them one. Now they have the Abrahamic house of worship in Dubai. I'm not talking about something in my, يعني, just to talk, it's a fact. So we need to understand that this is the fact that we are dealing with. We need to be able to understand what is going on around us. We need to hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And without doing what we're supposed to do, we will melt. We will be lost. So that's why we need to wake up and to make sure that we are upon the right path. Life is too short. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did create us to pass a test. We should not think about anything other than this test, to pass the test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Muslims, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there, Allah told them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Muslims, when they are obedient, they will be victorious. When they obeyed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they won the battle of Badr. When some of them disobeyed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the shu'm of their disobedience caused the killing of 70 Muslim leaders in the battle of Badr because of their disobedience. When they went to Hamra al-Asad with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the companions were talking to each other and saying, why? Why we lost the 70 people in the battle of Uhud? Why the mushrikeen were able to hurt us? We have the Prophet with us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are the believers. Why? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran, أَوَلَمَّا أَصَبَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَدْ أَصَبْتُمْ مِثْلَيْهَا قُلْتُمْ أَنَّ هَذَا قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. So it is because of you. What happened in the battle of Uhud? Because of you. Because of your disobedience. So the Muslims learned their lesson. They knew if they obey the Prophet, they will be victorious. If there is a strong iman in their heart, nobody can defeat the Muslims. If we are sinners and we are favoring this dunya over al-akhirah, we should not blame other than ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear to us in the Quran. قُلُوا هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. But for those who are doing their part, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is telling them, لَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. يعني do not weaken, do not grieve, and you will have the upper hand if you're real believers. If you're real believers, you will have the upper hand and you will be victorious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the same surah, in Surah Ali Imran, إِن يَمْسَسْكُمْ قَرْحٌ فَقَدْ مَسَّ الْقَوْمَ قَرْحٌ مِثْلُهُ وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. So, يعني if you are suffering your want, they are suffering their want too. They are suffering their injuries too. Allah said, وتلك الأيام نداولها بين الناس. يعني it means Allah alternates the days among people. So you will live a day of victory and a day of defeat. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when the Muslims followed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were victorious in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the time of the Khulafa, al-Rashidun, al-Mahdiyun, Abu Bakr, Umar, Rahman, Ali. You see, the Islam was growing in their time because of their obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of the strength of their iman. Same thing in the time of the Umayyads. The Muslims became the United States of Islam in the time of the Umayyads. And they were strong in the beginning. Once they started to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to favor dunya over akhirah, the Umayyads lost their kingdom. The Ummah did not lose its unity, but the leadership lost the position, because this leadership was not, at the end of its time, were not following the right path. So we found the Abbasids came, right? The Abbasids in the beginning, they were very strong. But what happened to them? Why they lost their kingdom? Why? Because they started to enjoy the luxury life and to favor this dunya over the akhirah. So they tested. They tested what? They suffered the crusaders. They suffered the Tatars, the Mongols. And just to have an idea of what happened in the time of the Tatars and the Mongols, Imam Ibn al-Athir is saying, when he was writing the history of Islam, he hesitated to write this part of the history, the part of the Tatar, of the Mongols. He was not able to write what happened, from how bad it is. So these Mongols, tribes, live on the southern border of China. They were united by Genghis Khan. And then they started to build their country, their kingdom. They started to grow gradually. And then Genghis Khan sent Hulagu to invade the Muslim land. Why did he choose the Muslim land? Because the Muslims were weak at that time. So they took advantage of their weakness, of their division. So in 2 months, they killed about 2 million Muslims. From the time they started the war until they arrived to the border of Baghdad. 2 million Muslims, do you imagine that? And they entered Baghdad and killed the Khalifa, al-Abbasi. So the Muslims lost their Khalifa. If you walk in the streets of Baghdad, you will see rivers of blood. Rivers of blood. The Muslims were completely psychologically defeated. And then the Mongols started to invade Greater Syria from the north, going down until they arrived to Gaza. And by the way, their defeat started from Gaza. It's a good thing to mention. Their end was in Gaza. Once they arrived to Gaza, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a good leadership to the Muslims. Qutuz, we call him Asad Ain Jalud. Qutuz united the Muslims, inspired them. He worked with Al-Izz ibn Abdul Salam, rahimahullah, to tell the Muslims to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to stop sinning, to be united, to prepare themselves to their enemy. Not only Al-Izz ibn Abdul Salam, Sheikh al-Islam Taymiyyah, same thing. And they prepared the Muslims, and the war started from Gaza. And alhamdulillah, they were able to defeat the Tatars in Gaza, and they liberated the Muslim cities and villages one after the other, until the big fight with them, which is called the Battle of Ain Jalud. Same thing happened in the time of the Crusaders before the Tatars, when the Crusaders invaded the Muslim land because of the weakness of the Muslims, because the Pope of the Christians wanted to unite the Christians and the churches under his flag, under his leadership, and he wanted a cause. And you know, the necessity and the war, the most thing bring people together. He was able to unite the churches under his leadership, and he started to invade the Muslim land because the Christians at that time were suffering economic problems and they needed the wealth of the Muslims. So they started to invade the Muslim land in the time of weakness. They were able to defeat them, to steal their wealth, to kill them, and to occupy their land. And they built a kingdom in Al-Quds. So they prevented the Muslims from praying in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa or even making one adhan for 92 years or 91 years. Imagine. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a good leadership to the Muslims. Imad al-Din Zinki, Nur al-Din Mahmud, Yusuf Shiriko, Yusuf Ayyub, Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi. And these people worked hard to return the Muslims back to their deen, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to prepare themselves to their enemy. And they were able to defeat their enemies and to liberate the Muslim land from the Crusaders. So now, after the falling of the Ottoman empires, when the West came, as Prophet Muhammad said, alayhi salatu wasalam, the Prophet said in hadith reported in Musnad Imam Ahmad, narrated by Thawban radiallahu anhu, he said, يُوشِكُ أَن تَدَاعَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْأُمَمْ كَمَا تَتَدَاعَ الْأَكَلَةُ إِلَىٰ قَسْعَتِهَا. يعني you are about to see the nations are conspiring, calling each other, coming together in unity against you. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, كَمَا يَتَدَاعَ الْأَكَلَةُ إِلَىٰ قَسْعَتِهَا. يعني hungry people, imagine hungry people are sitting around a tray, and this tray full of beautiful food. They are hungry. So everybody will eat. You will find one of them eating by his right hand, the other one will be eating by his left hand, the third one will be eating by his both hands. Everybody is eating, right? The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, كما تتداعى الأكلة إلى قصرتها. The Muslims said, the companions said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, is it because we will be a small amount in number, or messenger of Allah, just a few Muslims? The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, بل أنتم يومئذ كثير. No, at that time, you are a lot. Between me and you, I will tell you the secret. We are more than 1.5 million Sunni Muslims. I'm not counting the Shia either. We are more than 1.5 billion Muslims. The Prophet said, you are a lot. لكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل. What is غثاء السيل? If you imagine a river, the water is running to one direction. Anything you will throw, any garbage, any scum, you will throw on the top of the river, even if you see the rain is coming down, drops on the top of the water of the river will take everything to its direction. So the Muslims are like that. There is a river. The river is the West, right? The Christian and the Jew, they have the direction going very speed, in very strong speed. And they are taking you to their direction. You are not effective. You are weak. You are divided. You are not prepared. You don't know your identity. لكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, وَلَأَنْزِعَنَّ اللَّهُ الْمَهَابَةَ مِنْكُمْ مِنْ صُدُورِ عَدُوِّكُمْ. As punishment for our mistakes, Allah will take the fear of us from the hearts of our enemy. They will not be afraid of us. You know, the time of the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, نُصِرْتُ بِالرُّعْ مَسِيرَةَ عَامٍ. يعني in the time of the Prophet, if the Prophet announces that he is going to a war next year, his enemy would be afraid the entire year if he just announced. In this era that the Prophet is talking about, the fear of the Muslims would be taken out of the hearts of their enemy, so that the enemies of the Muslims would not be afraid of them. وَلَأَنْزِعَنَّ اللَّهُ الْمَهَابَةَ مِنْكُمْ مِنْ صُدُورِ عَدُوِّكُمْ وَلَيَقْذِفَنَّ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ الْوَهَنِ. Allah will install الْوَهَنِ in the hearts of the Muslims as punishment. The companions wanted to understand what is الْوَهَنِ. They said, what is الْوَهَنِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ? Which type of weakness you are talking about? So the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرْيَاتُ الْمَوْتِ. You will love this dunya and you hate to die. This is your bigger problem when you love this dunya. If you love this dunya, you will live for it. You will invest yourself, your life, your money, your everything just to attain this dunya, if you love it. And the Prophet came for the guidance of human beings. The Prophet came to tell people, love akhirah. Don't love this limited life, love al-akhirah. Love this limited life because only if you love it for the sake of Allah. You will love it to invest it, to build your future, to build your life, in the unlimited life after death. So love it from this way. So the Muslims who suffered the tactics of the disbelievers in the past, they may suffer the same tactics in the future of Islam, again and again and again. But we need to be guided by the Quran. The Quran is telling us to strengthen the iman in the heart, because once we have a strong iman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make us victorious. As he said, وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَوِّلْهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَلِيَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah wants you to show your iman to him. When you are in confrontation with your enemies, Allah wants you to show your strong iman. If you have iman, a strong iman in your heart, you will deserve the victory. You will deserve the support of Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already said in the Quran clearly, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهِ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. If you support Allah, Allah will support you. If you related to Allah, if you believe in Allah, Allah will make you victorious. He promised that in the Quran. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Done. Allah already promised those who believed and did righteous deeds. He said, لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah will give them a strong establishment on earth. If we are not getting that means we are not doing our job. We need to do our job. My brothers and sisters, we need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to feel this loyalty to each other and this loyalty to our Muslim brothers in Palestine. The problem of Palestine is not a problem of the Palestinians. This land is the endowment of Muslims. This land is waqf Islami. Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is the house of Allah. The city of Al-Quds is a blessed city that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Muslims, right? So the obligation upon us is to defend this land and to defend the city of Al-Quds and to defend Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Our Muslim brothers there, they have right upon us. I understand we don't have a lot to do. I understand. We don't have a lot to do. But we can do something. We can make dua. And don't belittle dua. The Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, الدعاء سلاح المؤمن. The dua is the weapon of the believer. And you just heard in the beginning of my talk how Prophet Muhammad SAW, when he made dua against 7 individuals from the tyrants of Quraysh, Allah accepted his dua in the battle of Badr, and all of them got killed and sent to hell. So when you make dua, Allah will accept it. You don't decide when Allah accepts your dua. Allah knows when to accept your dua. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. You just make your part. Make your dua. Keep your Muslim brothers in your dua all the time. Donate for them in a legitimate way. Find the legitimate way to support them financially. I understand it's completely closed. And even the organizations who are collecting money here in America, they are not able to send it until now. But when you donate, inshallah, one day Allah will open the door for this money to enter, as long as you have given the money to trusted people to find a legitimate way to send your support. And the most important thing is to be loyal to your brothers by your heart. This is something that you need to live with your 24/7. That you feel that your brothers are getting killed. You feel for them, for their suffering. You ask about what is going on with them. And if you are able to do something in the political field, do. If you can put pressures in the officials here in America for ceasefire, if you can use any tool, any political tool, to help your brothers with, do so. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see the Muslims loyal to each other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see the Muslims are supporting each other. Allah said subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُنصُرْ أَخَاك. Support your brother. ظَالِمًا أَوْ مَظْلُومًا. Whether he is right or wrong. If he's right, you support him because he's doing something right. If he's wrong, stop him from doing wrong. And that is your support to him. Allah said in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ آوَى وَنَصَرُوا أُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. Those who supported the brothers who need the support are the real believers. Allah is saying they are the real believers when they show support to their Muslim brothers. So wisely try to have something to do and don't just watch the movie. Sometimes we, from the amount of incidents, it became like a movie for us. We just watch the news and feel sad for seconds, and then once the, we step from the house out, or once we turn off the computer or the TV, so like the movie is over. It's not a movie, it's reality. And what is going on with them now may happen to others in certain in other time. We don't know, right? So we need to be always hand to hand, to be united, and to be righteous as much as we able to try to be close to Allah Azza wa Jal with the strong iman. وليعلم الله الذين امنوا الله سيد ويتخذ منكم شهداء والله لا يحب الظالمين ويتخذ منكم شهداء. It means one of the wisdoms behind what is going on that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to grant some of the believers the degree of martyrdom. They will never achieve this without being in these circumstances. So Allah, whatever you see, numbers of Muslims are getting killed, remember that if they are Muslims, if they are believers, if they are sincere, Allah will grant them the degree of martyrdom. Their reward would be great in the Day of Judgment. And if they are martyrs, they will not suffer the pain of the killing. The Prophet said that, alayhi salatu wasalam, الشهيد, the one who achieved martyrdom, the martyr, number one, with the first drop of blood comes out of his body, Allah forgives his sins. Number two, the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, the martyr will not feel the pain of the killing, except if it is like a pinch or a small bite, like a poke of a needle. Subhanallah. And number three, the Prophet said, "Yura maqadahu min al-jannah." So once his soul comes out, he will be seeing his place in Jannah, his reward, his compensation in Jannah immediately. And the Prophet said, "Alayhi wasalam, in the Day of Judgment, he will be given a crown to be known in front of all creation the Day of Judgment that he is martyr. He will intercede for 70 people from his family members. And he will be married to 70 hur'een in Jannah. It's a great reward. We need to see this positive part also, because we don't want to be down. Don't be down. Lift your head up. You should not be psychologically defeated. You need to lift your spirit up when you remember that what we are suffering now, the first Muslims suffered in the time of the Prophet too, right? And the great reward that Allah is offering for being patient is really great. It's really great, wallahi. We need to trust the promises of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know I took long. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. سبحانك اللهم ربنا وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم ارجو في الإسلام.